vacation. So thankful that you made it here safely, and hopefully you had a great vacation. For the first time in my life on a vacation, I wasn't ready to come home. I think I'm just hitting an age in my life where I don't want to do nothing. And I love church, and love. I'm glad that Mike and back. I love my grandkids and kids and stuff, but I'm just hitting them. Lori said to me, well, why don't we just move to South Carolina? So I ain't ready to go back like that, but yeah, so I'm envious of you all going on vacation. I already had one. I'm ready to go on vacation again. Lord help me. It's just such a blessing to have a church family. I don't know what we would do without you all, and it's such a blessing for people to trust you enough where they'll say, will you please pray for me? And I feel the same way when I know that when I ask you all to be in prayer for us about something, I know that you will do that. And that's just such a blessing to be able to go to someone in your church and know that they'll go before God's throne of grace for confidence with you. And along with that, it's such a blessing to know that we can go before God for direction. And I'll continue to say this to you all. Please go before God's throne of grace with confidence, asking the Lord, what is it that you would have me to do? And that's so important, because you want to make sure that you're serving in a church where God wants you to be at. So ask the Lord, where would you want me to serve at? What ministries would you want me to be in? And the same thing with giving. Ask God that. Lord, how much do you want me to give? In what ways do you want me to give? It's so important to do and be what God wants us to do and to be in the God's will. And I learned this a long time ago. I remember when I first got saved, and they would always say, you can't be God-giving. They would play that song, too. And I've seen that in my life. You truly can't be God-giving. And in our church, you can give a number of ways. You can go to the website, and you can give online. You can also bring your offering. We have an offering box in the back there. You can also mail your offering in. We truly can't be God-giving. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the great privilege to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Father, I thank you for the great privilege to fellowship with your children. And Father, I thank you for the great privilege to preach your word. Father, I pray this morning that we not only be hearers of your word, Father, but much more importantly, that we would be doers of your word. For it's in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray all these things. Amen. This month, Pastor Steve and I have been preaching on the topic of prayer. And today I'll be preaching on giving thanks to God. I'll be preaching from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16, 17, and 18. And in those three verses, and they are powerful verses, in this first letter that the Apostle Paul sent to the church of Thessalonica, there's only 19 words in these three verses. But there are three powerful commands in these three verses. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Give thanks to God. Give thanks to God in all circumstances. So as you can see, the first command, the Apostle Paul is commanding believers to rejoice always. And this means to be filled with joy. And I can remember when I was a young Christian hearing someone give a definition of what joy is, and they're saying happiness is based on circumstances in your life. Joy isn't based on the circumstances in your life. It's based on our relationship with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Are they servants of Christ? And this is the NIV. I like how the NIV version reads. I am out of my mind to talk like this. I am more. I have worked much harder. And this is the Apostle Paul writing here. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent the night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face daily the pressure of my concern for all the churches. Woo! And sometimes we complain about having a bad day. Well, wow, I've been going through a tough stretch here. I can't even begin to fathom all the suffering that the Apostle Paul was going through. But here in verse 16, he says, rejoice always. And this is an imperative. This is a command. And during this time period, the Christians in Thessalonica were also being persecuted. I want to read you a couple of verses there. For you, brothers and sisters, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. You suffered from your own people the same things those churches suffered from the Jews, who killed the Lord Jesus and the prophets and also drove us out. They displease God and are hostile to everyone. So he's sending this letter to the church in Thessalonica, and they're in the midst of being persecuted. And just, if you put yourself in their shoes, just think about some of the most difficult times that you've ever gone through in your life. And I'm just flashing through some of them. And then someone comes up to you and says, and they know what you're going through, and they say, brother, you need to rejoice. You might hit them. Do you know what I'm going through? Do you know the pain and suffering? Whether it's financial, health, emotionally. But yet here the Apostle Paul is telling us and told the church in Thessalonica to rejoice always. How do we have an attitude, a demeanor of being filled with joy when we're going through some of the most challenging and difficult times in our life? Oh, it's easy to be filled with joy when everything is going fine. Your bank account looks great. All your kids are doing well. Everyone's healthy. Red Sox win the World Series. But wow, how do we have a mentality? How do we demonstrate being filled with joy when things aren't going well on the job? You're laid off. You're let go. You're enduring sickness. Loved ones enduring sickness. And this is always the toughest one. When it's children or grandchildren who are going through sickness, and you don't know what the outcome will be with them. How do you be filled with joy in those kind of circumstances? How are you filled with joy when your kids are going astray? And Lord knows, everything that I've talked about just now, we have experienced. It's hard. Breaks your heart in situations like that. Yet the Apostle Paul, and he's in God's will, saying, rejoice always. Philippians 4:4 tells us, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Church, in order to rejoice always, we have to have a strong faith. And remember, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It's hard to believe when you're in the midst of a trial, when you're in the midst of persecution, when you're going through difficult times, your loved ones are going through difficult. It's hard, isn't it, to have faith when you're worried? But everything that we believe in as Christians is based on faith. We have to pray consistently. God, give me greater faith. God, please fill me with the Holy Spirit. And I'll never forget this, when I was a young Christian, and one of my first pastors said this, and he shared with me, and he preaches, but you know, sometimes when a pastor is preaching and you feel like they know, like, did you have a camera in my house? How do you know what's going on in my mind? How do you know what I said? And I'll never forget, he said, brother, sisters. But it was like, he was like, lays it in on me. And that's when I was wrestling with, how am I going to follow God's calling and go to seminary so I can be trained, and I want to be a minister, I want to be a pastor. And he said, brother, sisters, how can you talk to other people about stepping out on faith if you haven't done it? We have to step out on faith. And when we do, and then we see God answer prayers. And when you pray, you have to trust and believe in that prayer. We've had situations with kids going astray. I never once doubted through prayer that God was going to change the hearts of our son who had gone astray. And he's doing wonderful now. And this has been years ago, but you have to pray with faith. Times when our kids were going through terrible health situations and could have possibly died. And I know some of you have experienced that too. By faith, I knew the Lord was going to bring them through. Trusted and believed in it. But we have to pray for God to give us faith, and then we have to step out on faith. And that's hard. But once you do it and you see God answer the prayers, it becomes easier and easier. And you have more confidence. And you know, if you haven't stepped out on faith, and then you try to share with another person about giving or about prayer, you think you'll be convincing? No. You know when you talk to someone and they're saying one thing, and you look them right in the eyes, and you can say, I can tell. You saying it, but you ain't did it. You ever look at someone? You can look at the person in their eyes and tell. But you can also look in the person's eyes, and you can see conviction and strength and faith in the person's eyes, too. And you know, I can listen to that brother. I can listen to that. I can tell. They've been there. And they've got through it. The apostle, a brother or sister like the Apostle Paul, I'm going to follow them. They've been there. And they've had the struggle. And they came out stronger for the Lord on the other side. Now, I'm not going to lie to you, church. I want the easy way. I don't think anyone wants to go through all those difficult, trying times. But I can also say they've made me the man of God that I am today. And I'm still a work in progress. But the most difficult times in my life, when God challenged my faith and Lori's faith, and we trusted in God and we held on to his unchanging hand, they made us stronger, our faith. And then it helps us to be able to minister to other people in a stronger way because of that. But once again, I'm not going to lie, I'm in front of you preaching. If I can have the easy way out, I'm going to take that one. But if the Lord says, no, Bon, you're going to go through a storm. With his unchanging hand, we can get through that. Secondly, his second command, pray continually. Pray without ceasing. Well, how do you do that? There's other things that we have to do. We have to go to work. If you're stay-at-home mom or dad, you have the kids to take care of. There's all kind of other responsibility. What if you don't feel 100%? And God understands that. But it's having an attitude or a mindset of praying. Throughout the day, I'm praying. And you all have heard me say this before. When I'm watching grandkids, sometimes I may get a text message from church regarding a situation for somebody. I'll drop my head right then in the kitchen and start praying. Got to hurry up because Amina's fast and she might try to get into something. Throughout the day, I'm going through the house or I'm out. I'm saying, Lord, give me strength to do all that I have to do this day. Lord, help me. When I'm driving, I'm praying. And I've been practicing this for so long that I am praying continually throughout the day, lifting people up in prayer. You know, God is God. And there is something to having a posture of prayer, getting on your knees and being in your prayer closet alone, bowing your head, closing your eyes. But God understands if we're busy too. And praying out loud. Pray continuously. And oftentimes when I'm praying in front of our grandchildren, it's setting a great example for them and making prayer fun for them. When I pray with Amina, and now it's just automatic. I put my hands down and she'll put her little hands in my hands, and then I'll grab her hands and we thank God for food, and at the end, we do this now, and we go, amen. And she's right here with me. And I've had the privilege to help watch all three of Mike and Daniel's kids. And God has just given me an opportunity to have a real influence on their lives. And praying with them. And some of you who have been here for a while know this, and those of you who haven't been here as long don't know this, but like Tyson, when he's going through a situation, he'll tell his parents, call Pap off of me. I want him to pray for me. That's faith. Even at a young age, we can develop that in our kids, that they'll pray continually. So for those who have young children, pray with them out loud. with your grandchildren, pray with them out loud. And have great faith when you pray. Don't pray like, well, Lord, I'm just so scared. I don't know if my son or daughter is going to get off those drugs. But if it be your will, could you please get... We got to come before God's throne of grace with confidence. That means being bold. Lord God, I know you are the creator of the universe. I know you have great plans for my child. Lord, by faith, I know you're going to deliver them. Now, that's praying with faith, confidence, believing. You want, if someone's coming to you about something, do you want them coming before you with a request? Well, I don't know, maybe, or I know I can do this. Give me the opportunity, I'll show you. You want people to have faith. God wants us to have faith when we come before his throne of grace with confidence. Whether it's confession, intercession, petition, or thanksgiving. Come before God with faith, and you'll see God work in mysterious ways, in miraculous ways, in mighty ways. And then lastly, the Apostle Paul gave his third command. Give thanks in all circumstances. I'm thinking like, in all circumstances? I'm supposed to thank God when I'm going through a storm? Am I supposed to thank God when I'm struggling? You can pray, Lord, I know you are the creator of the world. Lord, I know you created me. You know everything about me. Lord, I know you're going to deliver me through this storm. And Lord, I know you're going to use it in a mighty way to help me to minister to other people. God wants us to be positive. And some of the most difficult times that I've gone through in my life, and once again, I'm in church and I'm preaching. I can't lie to you. Every time when a storm hits me, the first thing that I say isn't always, praise the Lord. I'm not going to lie. Sometimes when I'm, especially when it's kids or grandkids, sometimes when I've got a phone call about one of our grandkids going through something or one of my kids, sometimes the first thing I've done was, for some reason, I lose the strength in my legs and I go down like this. Sometimes I've done that and I've cried first. Then I get myself back together and I'll pray. We're human and we have emotions. We have feelings. But God desires for us to look beyond the difficult times. And church, I promise you, if you have faith, always trusting and believing that there's a purpose for why God is allowing you to go through a difficult time, you'll grow from that. And I've learned, and I'm sure some of you, many of you have learned this also, when you go through those difficult times, and even sometimes we waver because we're human, we get back on track and have faith, and we thank God for being there with us through that storm. We thank God for, Lord, I thank you for how you're going to get me through this storm, how you're going to get me through this trial. And then when you do, whoo, does that increase your faith? And you'll be amazed, and maybe you won't because you've seen this, but how God will bring people to you who've had similar situations, And wow, can you minister to them in a powerful way? Because you've been in the eye of the storm. I can tell when a person has been in the eye of the storm. And then when they're sharing with me, and it increases your faith. So can you imagine everyone in church being like that? How we can minister to one another so powerfully with that? And many of you had shared with me situations that you've gone through as a child throughout your life. And it builds our faith so much. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And it's possible to do that. God never calls us to do something without preparing us for that. And Jesus is always with us. The Holy Spirit is always with us. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The key to giving thanks to God in all circumstances is knowing Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, knowing that we have the Holy Spirit living in us. And we have a great God who loves us so much that he gave his only begotten Son. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for these three powerful, great commands. Father, I pray that we would rejoice always. Father, I pray that we would pray continuously. And Father, I pray that we would give thanks in all circumstances. Father, please fill us with the Holy Spirit. Father, please give us great faith. And Father, please use us in a powerful way to minister to other people. For it's in the mighty name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
You guys can go ahead and stand up if you're feeling up to it. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can come before your throne of grace with great confidence. Father, please help us to have great faith. Father, fill us with the Holy Spirit. We rejoice always. That even in the midst of storms, Father, we can thank you because we know, Father, that you are a great God. And there is no circumstance, Father, that is greater than you. And Father, help us to have great faith. that we will pray continuously. Father, use us in a powerful way to minister to other brothers and sisters in the Lord. And now may the love of God the Father and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. And all God's children said, amen. God bless you and have a wonderful week.